we're talking about life, we're talking about death. और आज हमारा इंटरेक्शन होगा एक पहुंचे हुए वैदिक स्कॉलर. When I say वैदिक, which means a dialogue between a doctor and a doctor. एक डॉक्टर जो फिजिकल बॉडी का डॉक्टर है, डॉक्टर के अग्रवाल, और एक रूहानी डॉक्टर जो कि सोल का डॉक्टर है. There will be a dialogue between two doctors of a different kind. That's what I call it as. That's the reason I called it as a conversation with His Holiness. That I am a doctor, trained doctor for physical body. जब मैंने MBBS किया था तो मुझे mental health शायद एक दो क्लास में पढ़ाई गई थी. Intellectual health maybe half an hour session. Social health maybe few months. And spiritual health मेरे को पढ़ाई नहीं गई. बोले इसके बारे में भूल जाओ. We were not taught the concept of consciousness in my medical life at all. And this knowledge I acquired over a period of time. So we will have a dialogue between two different types of pathies, a Vedic philosophy and an allopathic philosophy. I call them as Aloveda. Alo means allopathy and Veda means Vedic knowledge. क्या दोनों का कहीं पर यूनियन संभव है कि नहीं है? We will like to explore today.
गुरुर् ब्रह्मा, गुरुर् विष्णु, गुरुदेवो महेश्वरा, गुरु साक्षात् परब्रह्म, तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः. परम पूज्य स्वामी जी, my humble pranams at your holy feet. I feel very honored to say a few words about Swamiji. 8 years back, on a similar theme, I had the occasion to hear Swamiji and my life was transformed. So you don't know what you are in for after this 1 or 2 hours with Swamiji. Swamiji is an inspiring figure in the field of Vedanta, and he is bringing Vedanta to every door in India today. When I say it, I mean it literally. And whatever misconceptions are there about Shankaracharya's commentary on the Prasthanatrayi, Bhagavad Gita, the 10 Upanishads and the Brahma Sutra, Swamiji is taking us back to the original and showing us, for example, that Shankaracharya ji has nowhere said that Jagat is Mithya. This has been a very, very big mission on which Swamiji has been all his life almost, and much more intensely last 30 to 35 years. And I think it is bearing its fruits, because somewhere Vedanta has gone into oblivion, or people thought it's something they cannot follow, because what they see, if it is told to them that is illusion, it's very difficult to digest. But this is not what Shankaracharya ji has said, and this Swamiji brings out very, very clearly from the commentaries of Shankaracharya. Besides this, what we all have learned from Swamiji is from his personal way of living. He's a preceptor. And I'll give you one little example, because this is an audience consisting of doctors. Swamiji sits on the floor and eats. And he says that's the best posture to follow. We can all vouchsafe that, because we know sitting and eating on the dining table, using Western toilet, and standing kitchen for women has made it very easy for people to make lot of money with knee surgeries today. None of us are able to use our knees properly by the time we are in our 50s. This is just a simple example to show how, if we follow the Vedas to the letter, our lives will be more happy. This is what Swamiji says. Now, I'll just mention 2-3 things. I don't want to stand between you and Swamiji. But Swamiji has, over years, through his conversations with people, come out with a few books. And the first one was Foundations of Dharma, which was first published in English. But it has been published in Hindi, Tamil, and soon it will be out in Malayalam, and probably in Russian and German too. Similarly, his book Vedant Prabodh is a text on Vedanta of a very, very special type, exactly in the tradition of Shankaracharya, based on the commentaries of Shankaracharya. And this book has been first written in Kannada, translated into Hindi, and now translated into Malayalam, Gujarati, Telugu, and soon it will be out in Tamil. Another book which has been brought out recently is a Bhashya, a commentary on the Chatusutri Brahma Sutra called Sreyaskari. And this has been engaging the attention of scholars and sannyasis, and a lot of discussion is taking place on that. And soon this book will also come out in English. So, and there are still two other books. One is in Kannada, The Life of a Mahaparivrajaka Shankaracharya. And similarly, soon you will see a book on the Srishti Krama, that is the creation, cycle of creation. And this is also a very interesting aspect which Dr. Aggarwal was saying, you know, how to link the two systems. So this is another very unique feature of our learning with Swamiji, that he is so conversant with science and the modern science and the language. So for many people, it becomes much more easy to learn the scriptures because he is able to cite examples from modern science, though he is so well aware of the limitations of its methods. With these words, I would again do my pranams at the feet of Swamiji and leave you with him. Thank you.
Swamiji, we are working on a campaign, and that campaign is based on Savitri and Satyavan. We feel medically that Savitri was the one who saved Satyavan in our mythology by reviving a dead person. If it is possible, then medically it is possible to revive after death. We say that within 10 minutes of normal temperature, if the temperature is more than 35 degrees, the soul does not leave the body and the brain remains alive. If your temperature at the time of death is less than 35, then you can revive the body even after hours. Even after 12 hours of death, you can revive medically. We have named a campaign called Campaign Savitri. We call them as Savitri Yagya. Savitri Yagya means how to revive a person within 10 minutes of death. So when we talk about life after death, we are dividing life after death within 10 minutes after 10 minutes. So within 10 minutes, anybody can revive, all of you can revive a person. We have named the campaign as Savitri Yagya to perform your Savitri Dharma, which means your purpose of life is to save somebody's life. And if that person dies in front of you in less than 10 minutes, that's your Dharma, which can be remembered by the word Savitri Mantra. And the Savitri Mantra is, within 10 minutes of death, earlier the better, at least for the next 10 minutes, longer the better, instead of beating your chest, apni chhati peetne ke badle mare hue aadmi ki chhati peeto. Instead of beating your chest, beat the chest of the person who has died. This can be done by Savitri Asan. Savitri Asan is standing like this. This is Savitri Asan. Using Savitri Mudra, this is Savitri Mudra, and then Savitri Karm. In the center of the chest, compress the center of the chest of a dead person. If you do that, within 10 minutes of death, 80% of life can be saved. So I have created it to remember, and we are training it everybody. And I want Swamiji to inaugurate this session by just giving a pose, as if Swamiji is also saying is ki marve aadmi ko jinda kar sakte ho. Personally feel this might have been what Savitri did to Satyavan, and when she was fighting with Yamraj. Yamraj is standing and he's waiting for 10 minutes, and she did something and she revived Satyavan. Satyavan was a person who had a history of a possible sudden cardiac death. He was a heart patient as per mythology. And I feel this is at least something. First 10 minutes of death we have conquered. Medically, first 10 minutes of death we have conquered, and all of you can become a sadhu, a spiritual healer, a ruhani doctor of first 10 minutes, a ruhani doctor of first 10 minutes, by reviving a particular person. Now I'll hand it over to Swamiji to give his discourse, and then there will be, I will be, my discussion with him will be on certain aspects. First of all, some of things he may like to cover in his lecture. I'm putting some unanswered questions from a medical perspective. From a medical perspective, I know that my physical body, my life is only 2 years. Every cell in my body regenerates in 2 years. That means my nails, my hairs, so my skin, my liver changes. If my liver is totally dead, it regenerates in 6 weeks. That means it is possible to revive my liver in 6 weeks. It is possible to revive my skin in 4 weeks. It is possible to revive my stomach in 5 weeks. It is possible to regenerate my complete skeletal system in 12 weeks and the complete bone in 1 year. So in complete 2 years, I regenerate my whole body. One aspect of that is, if it is possible to regenerate your body, that means it is possible to cure your cancer. That means if I have a liver cancer, and I know my liver cancer cell life is only 2 years, and 2 years later, if my new liver cells are not cancerous cells, then it is possible to cure cancer. So one aspect of life after death is, when there is a death of a particular segment of the body, is it possible to cure that? Medically, we have been thinking about that. What Vedic knowledge talks about that? That's one. Second question I would like to explore possibility is, when we talk about Katha Upanishad, we talked about Nachiketa sacrifice and Nachiketa fire. We have never understood, because no books talks about this. This is a knowledge, the sacrifice will be named after the name of Nachiketa. What is that? I don't know. Third is, when we talk about karma, when we talk about past life, lots of doctors says we can do a past life regression. We would like to know some Vedic examples of past life regression. That's another thing. The fourth thing is that, is hell and heaven in the same world? I personally feel is, when I read Srimad Bhagavat, I read description of a hell. Ki hell ke andar mein log kadai mein talte hain. Hell ke andar mein log aapko kode maar rahe honge. Hell ke andar mein log aapko, you are without clothes. You are lying in stool and urine. There will be log bhale chubha rahe, draggers chubha rahe honge aapko. That's what description of Srimad Bhagavat is. And when I close my eyes and when I enter my ICU every day, I see the same thing. Log bhale chubha rahe hain, ek drip yahan lagai, ek drip yahan lagai, ek drip yahan lagai, ek drip yahan lagai. Log kode maar rahe hain, physiotherapy chal rahi hai. Log aapko electric current de rahe hain, radiotherapy mil rahi hai aapko. Aapke kapde gire pade hain, you are passing stool and urine, you are lying on the stool and urine all the time. Is that hell? Is hell and heaven the same thing? Is life after death, is death at the same time? People say that agar achhe kaam nahi karoge to akla janam achha nahi milega. As a doctor, I am not bothered about my next janam. And as a doctor, I am not bothered about my previous janam. I am only bothered if you come to me as a healer, and if you are 50, my concern is ki main agle 20 saal achhe kaise doon. So for me, your next janam is next 20 years. Not aapke marne ke baad. I am not going to wait ki aap maroge to agla janam achha mile. As a doctor, my concern is ki aap mere paas aayo galtiyan karke. Now for the next 20 years, main aapki zindagi kaise hell se heaven mein convert kar dun. Usko karne ke liye, as a medical doctor, aap mere ko kya knowledge denge ki main usko incorporate kar sakun meri practice mein, taki mere patients aaj se apni hell ki zindagi se heaven mein ja sakein. Aur unka jo future birth hai, that means birth from tomorrow, aaj raat ko jo mar jayenge, kal subah jab paida honge, so for me, my future birth is from tomorrow. How to improve that? These are some of the questions which I will be interacting with him to get some answers, so that we can incorporate some of his Ruhani powers into our medical practice, so that we can become a good medical healer, not a doctor. That will be the way, Swamiji, I would interacting with you after your discourse. So all yours, Swamiji, and bye-bye.
I'm very happy to be here. Thank you, Dr. Aggarwal. When I arrived here, I had a sort of a very worldly, practical point of view. So accordingly, I should tell certain things which will hopefully give you a sort of a new vision to look into problems of that you come across as doctors. I want to indicate by small logic that there is rebirth. There were previous lives. Okay? And then I will describe the process of death. While describing the process of death, I will give the structure of the body as described in the Shastras. Okay? And how much it makes contact with modern allopathy. Okay? Then I will give the process of death and about life after death also, Swarga Naraka that you mentioned. And then also I will come back to the process of rebirth. You will see there is a remarkable reciprocity between the two processes. Okay? Now afterwards we can take more questions, and I don't know how far we will be able to answer those questions, but let me try. Okay? Now to start with, first note that there must have lapsed previous lives also for each one of us. Because there are too many ideas, I will be, without sacrificing clarity, I should like to be brief. Okay? Please, for instance, you take a small child, a baby, hardly 1 year. It has started speaking. Okay. Now, the mother shows the child a certain cow and says, "Gai, gai, 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 dekho, dekho." Then it recognizes the sound and says, "Gai, gai." Okay. After 4 or 5 days, when the child is alone coming outside and the mother is inside, the child shouts, "Ma, ma, gai, gai." She's scared and she comes back. She sees to her surprise that there is a very big cow, okay, which is very dissimilar to the cow that she had shown 3 or 4 days ago. Okay. Now the question is, by just showing one single cow, how is it that the baby has been able to recognize an extremely dissimilar cow? That's also a cow, there's only similarity, but completely different in all the details. Okay? This question itself is very, very deep. In fact, if we may have to discuss it for a few days. It is so complex as that. Okay? Therefore, this is an indication that the child is already possessing a knowledge of the cow-ness. That the gotva, as they say. Okay? No, it knows what a cow is. Only it is picking up what exactly is the word used in this house for this cow. Therefore, if it is already possessing a knowledge of the cow, when should it have got the knowledge? It should be only in the previous lives. Okay? In fact, in this connection, so all of you should know, the origin of languages, yeah? Very big people like Noam Chomsky and others, they have looked into it and they have proved, of course I can give a lot of evidence for that also, that a knowledge of universal grammar is actually genetic. It's in the blood, it's in the genes. So, this is possible only when you accept that there have been several births. Okay? With this, I will stop with that issue. Now comes the question, how the process of death takes place. For that, I will have to give a description of the body. This body that you see, the grass body, it's called sthula sharir, and this body is really inert, jada. In other words, what does it mean? It means it cannot work by itself, being jada. You know that. You are sitting erect and all that, but going to sleep, then you will fall down. What does it mean? It means that the whole body will have to be propped from inside. Otherwise, it won't stand. So this shows that the body is jada. Therefore, there must be force fields within the body to keep it active, to make it act. Okay? And what are they? You say, they're actually in three groups. First is the motor organs. The motor organs are vak, pani, pada, payu, upastha. The speech, pani, pada, and payu, upastha. The two lower ones. Okay, these are the motor organs. Now, all these things we can club into one single name, namely vak. By vak, I mean all the five motor organs. Then you have the five sense organs, okay, all of you know, and also the mind. Okay, by mind, actually we include four aspects: the mind, the intellect, and the memory, and also the ego, and all the five sense organs. Taking all the nine together, I call it as manas, that is the mind. The second one. And the third one is the prana. The prana is all the whole respiratory system. Okay? Actually, it is five. Now, I will give some more details. The motor organs, they are functioning. Okay? When I say, for instance, hand, this itself is not the arm. This itself is not the indriya. That is, of course, if you say English terminology, it's called as organ. It's not an organ, it's an indriya. It's not the thing. The strength behind that, which makes it act like this, that is called pani indriya. It's called indriya. Okay? It is not the hand. Because you can know it very easily, because if there is paralysis, this cannot function. So what is gone wrong with, not with this hand itself, but it is with the karmendriya. Okay. Therefore now, this, all the five motor organs will be functioning. Now, in order to function, obviously, these indriyas need food. Okay. What exactly is the food? The Shastra says, the fat content that you eat, that is in ghee, oil and all that. This fat content, when it is digested, it splits into three parts. The crudest part goes to the bones, and the middle part goes to the marrows, and the subtlest part goes to the karmendriyas, the vak. This, I am told, has been known in allopathy only about 50 years ago. Okay.